Systemic Lupus Erythematosus, Part 2 of 2. Once again, here are our learning objectives. In this talk, we will be focusing more on the last two objectives highlighted here. We will continue discussing the classification criteria and then discuss some special situations involving SLE. Having already discussed the laboratory-based criteria last time, we will pick up with the rest of the clinical criteria. The malar rash is also referred to as the butterfly rash. While this is considered the classic rash of lupus, only 30 to 60% of patients will have a malar rash at any given time during their disease. The malar rash is generally raised erythematous and covers the upper part of the cheeks and across the bridge. A clinical pearl is that a true malar rash typically spares the nasolabial folds. Finally, this rash can wax and wane with the course of the disease. Unlike the malar rash, discoid lesions tend to leave permanent scars. While discoid lesions can occur in the setting of SLE, some people can have the rash without other systemic features. Unfortunately, discoid rashes tend to have a predilection to involve the face and scalp. However, discoid rashes are only present in up to 15 to 30% of patients with lupus. Ulcers. While these can occur anywhere in the mouth, they tend to be found on the hard palate. Patients can also develop ulcers in the nasal pharynx. Oral and nasal ulcers in lupus tend to be painless and must be observed by a physician in order to meet the classification criteria. The arthritis found in lupus patients tends to be non-erosive and reducible. It is due primarily to an increase in joint laxity. In severe cases, lupus arthritis produces a Jacoud's arthropathy, which refers to reducible swan neck deformities of the fingers. Nephritis. One of the more severe clinical manifestations of SLE is renal involvement, which affects up to two-thirds of lupus patients. For classification purposes, lupus nephritis is defined as 0.5 grams of proteinuria per day, or the presence of CAS noted on a urinalysis. A renal biopsy is important not only for staging the disease, but also for helping to guide treatment decisions. Serositis refers to the irritation of the pleura covering the heart or the lungs and can affect up to one-third of patients with SLE. Long-standing pleuritis or pericarditis can lead to pleural and pericardial effusions, respectively. The neuropsychiatric manifestations of SLE are among the most difficult to diagnose and treat. While official classification criteria list seizures and psychosis, it is often hard to determine whether these manifestations are due to lupus or other comorbid conditions. Additionally, lupus patients can develop a number of other neurologic complaints, such as cognitive impairment or demyelinating disorders. While patients with lupus can have a number of complications during pregnancy, one that is of particular concern to the fetus is the so-called neonatal lupus. Babies of mothers with anti-Rho antibodies are at risk of developing congenital heart block. The mechanism of this is that the autoantibodies can cross the placenta and cause damage to the developing fetal cardiac conduction system. Neonatal lupus is associated with anti-Rho or SSA or anti-Law or SSB antibody positivity. 80% of babies born with neonatal lupus are found to have a mother with positive anti-Rho or Law antibodies, while only 6% of babies born to mothers with known anti-Rho or Law antibodies will develop neonatal lupus. In addition to congenital heart block, neonatal lupus can also be manifested in the baby as a rash, but this usually disappears in about 3 months once the mother's antibodies have been cleared from the system. The last special situation that tends to show up on board exams is drug-induced lupus. Unlike patients with systemic lupus erythematosus, those with DIL tend to have more limited involvement, primarily of the skin and joints. Also, there must be a temporal relationship with the initiation of certain medications, such as those listed here. Hydralazine, minocycline historically have been two that have been known to cause this reaction, but more recently, some of the biologic medications, such as the anti-TNF inhibitors, have been associated as well. To help with diagnosis, those patients often have a positive antibody in an antihistone pattern, Most importantly, these patients generally improve with removal of the offending medication. In summary, we have spent the majority of the time discussing the classification criteria for SLE, which were developed to aid patient inclusion in clinical trials. However, it is important to note that SLE can cause a multitude of other organ problems that were not presented here in these lectures. Additionally, please be aware that the fetuses of mothers with anti-Rho antibodies are at risk for congenital heart block and thus must be followed closely during the pregnancy with fetal echocardiograms. Lastly, drug-induced lupus is a self-limited phenomenon associated with certain medications. It is associated with positive antihistone ANA and usually resolves following removal of the offending medication.